Hey everybody, what's going on?
What's going on?
In this video, we're going to be talking about the Origami King, and this is going to be our sort of review discussion about the video because I've played and completed this game now. Takes me a lot longer to complete games these days, but I finally did it. First, I'm not going to, like, we're not going to number rating this thing. Like, I'm not going to put a number on this thing, like a 1 through 10. Yeah. because I don't, like, that stuff's so subjective, and it's sort of like, I don't know, rating systems suck anymore. And it's like anything below 6 is basically a 0, which is stupid. So yeah, you might as well just have a 1 to 4 rating. So no number. We're just going to like talk about the game for its own merits and everything. And also I want to lead off and say right off the bat, this is a great game.
Oh, like, I'm surprised.
I would actually say, and I was a little skeptical and everything going in, and I had heard all the things. And I have, you know, like I grew up playing the originals, but I would actually say that this is, for me anyway, going down as one of the better Switch games out there.
Oh, wow. So, big change in your opinion.
Yeah. Starting off strong. And I know that's a slightly unpopular opinion, but you know what?
Fuck
'em. Damn it. It's a good, it's a good fucking game. So starting off the story, it's serviceable. I would say it's good, but it's not anything complex or anything that you really have to think about or reflect on. I mean, it's a Nintendo game. It's a family friendly game. It's a Mario game. It's better. It's on the better end of a Mario game story for sure. But Paper Mario's usually are. So it's nothing crazy off the wall. It's not the best in the series, but it's certainly not the worst. And there is some surprisingly deep and grim elements that happen along the way. And I'll say this, like, I'm not gonna get into spoiler territory at all or talk about any events because of all the negative, you know, reviews and opinions out there that there might be a lot of people straying from this. And I'm here to try to convince people that you should try it. And so therefore,
lead them back into the light. Come on.
yes. And I would also say that I did not 100% the game, and I played for about 35 hours, which is roughly what I've been seeing people say about it. So if I had to put a percentage of what I completed in this game, I'd say it's probably 65, 70 at most. So
a little bit over halfway.
Yeah, and I would say that if you were to 100% this game, find all the collectibles and stuff like that, it would you could probably get upwards of like 50 or so hours out of this thing.
That's pretty decent amount of gameplay for a game.
Yeah, it definitely did not overstay its welcome, but it was not short at all. Like, I mean, I know people have more free time than I do, but it definitely took me a while to get through it. And I was not like dragging my ass. Like I said, I completed like maybe 65 to 70%, but most of that kind of happens naturally as you're just going through, and I really was just trying to make my way through.
A lot of people of course have compared it to other Paper Mario story wise and the race of the writing also. I was curious about that because I know what Paper Mario's, when I understand, they try to interlace a certain kind of humor into the series. And I was wondering, comparing this one to other installments of the franchise, how would you rate the story and also kind of the humor that they try to go for? Did they keep up with that, or did they fall off a little bit?
Yeah, the story, like I said, it's not as good as something like The Thousand Year Door. And to be fair, I think that's why this game gets so much gets shit on so much, is because quite frankly, it's people are mad that it's not A Thousand Year Door, basically. And it's not. But that doesn't mean that it's a bad game. It's actually giving me confidence that if they continue with this type of direction where they keep changing and making things different, I know as much as we all, myself included, would like to see, you know, one go back to its roots, but it does give me more confidence that it's okay to let these things go and let these developers try new things. And the writing, the humor in the writing is top notch. I would say it's up there. It might be one of the best as far as the humor is concerned.
Okay.
So there are times where the language is a bit flat and dull, but I would say 7-8 times out of 10 in dialogue sections is great. There's some sections that are just flat out amazing. And there's other sections where I was just like, that's lame.
Is it like a drier comedy, or is it more like quirky observational humor? I'm curious, what is the humor that kind of prevails in this series?
It's definitely quirky, and there's a lot of dad joke things mixed in there, especially with the toads that you find. And as someone that kind of rolls their eyes sometimes when it comes to dad jokes, I can say wholeheartedly that this game delivers. Like, the dad jokes are, they're entertaining, they're fun, they're worth it. I wanted to hear what every single toad that you found said. Every time I entered a new area, I made a point to talk to every NPC. So moving on, we have visuals, right? This is another easy one to talk about, because I think everyone unanimously agrees that the visuals in this game are also sort of top notch for a Paper Mario game. They're fantastic. This was another thing that I was on the fence about, because when looking at the trailers and everything, I wasn't quite sure how I felt about the mix between paper and origami and like this faux 3D folded texture and then the flat paper textures. But in the end, it ended up blending pretty well. It's a great looking game. That being said, I was kind of surprised. Now, I don't know. I'm sure Digital Foundry or other, resources have stated what this is, but I'm not sure what the exact resolution is on these things. But I can tell you this. There's no way that it's full HD. And if it is, something else is going on. Because if I have this on my dock, on the TV, you can definitely see, hard or pixelated edges. So either the polygon count's low or it's not full HD. And that was actually kind of surprising given the art style and simplicity of the game. That being said, I'm kind of nitpicking here, because it's really not problematic. And if you're far enough back from your TV, you're not even going to notice it anyway. But it was one of those, I would get close and some things weren't sharp and, a little jagged. And I was like, why? but it looks great. In general, it looks great, handheld and TV.
Yeah,
so the visuals,
but the optimization for the handheld.
Yeah, everything looks great. I would say there's probably surprisingly a decent amount of stuff going on, considering that there's a lot of water effects and stuff that go on throughout the game. And of course, it's all based in paper. And actually, there's certain moments when you're using one of the Velementals in the game, without talking too much, the water Velemental, and it uses a realistic water effect, and it's one of the best water effects I've seen in any game on any platform. It's like next gen level water. You're like, whoa. And it's used so seldom, but it's almost weird, because every other element of water in the game is based on paper.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that they chose to do that, it's like they almost just wanted to test what they could do with water in on the Switch or something. Because it's a bit out of place, but visuals, I'm gonna say just about what everybody else says, they're great.
Okay. Sounds good.
I know they went with that, like you said, that new route with the origami and the 3D folding. So if you were to compare this to other previous installments, did you have one installment that was your kind of your preferential look to the game, or was this one actually the one that hit it out of the park for you?
I'm old school, like a lot of other people. So I really loved the aesthetic to Thousand Year Door. Back then, they weren't focused so much on the paper aesthetic as they were going for more of a storybook element. And paper was just sort of a subset of that. And a lot of people actually argue about this new design ever since, Sticker Star, Color Splash, and everything started really putting heavy focus on paper.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people have issues with that. And this is where I sort of say, paper is in the title. It's called Paper Mario. So I don't care what the history or what the origin really was. It really is in line with what it's trying to be. So like I think that it makes perfect sense that they continue going, you know, balls deep on this paper aesthetic. And I think, like I said, even this one, like I at first I was like, ugh, I really like this 3D added effect with the origami. It just doesn't look that great. But after you see it in person and start playing, it really does look pretty gorgeous. So it's probably technically the best looking, you know, from an aesthetic point of view. But on a more subjective point of view, sometimes like the paper mache stuff, I'd be like, take it or leave it. And the overall setting and environment and colors of like something like Thousand Year Door, like I really like that rustic, almost like piratey vibe, you know, that old, you know, that more time period sort of aesthetic that game had versus like these rich colors of so these
this
newer
one's
games.
More vibrant.
Yeah, it's okay. This one's more in line with Color Splash.
Okay.
Absolutely. Okay. But yeah, this one basically takes what Color Splash did and maybe kicks it up a slight notch. Bam, 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 bam. Let's move on to the next thing, which is going to be audio. And this is exciting because this is what I would think would probably be the best aspect of this game. The music in this game is so good.
Oh, okay.
This is really one of my favorite recent soundtracks to a game that I've heard. My favorite track in the entire game would have to be Shroom/Sniffit City. It's so good. There's like this, it's kind of almost like this Las Vegas casino party city. But there's like this techno mixed into it. It's fantastic on all fronts, but the music in there it's just amazing. I could listen to that track all day. I spent so much time in there trying to 100% complete that area, which I did just because I love the soundtrack there so much.
That's a really good point you have there where soundtracks really do make a lot of the enjoyability of being in certain towns, villages, venues in a game. And I have found myself in certain times in games, even though the tasks were arbitrary, but the music strangely keeps you there and kind of leave the town going, why the hell did I spend like 15 hours in that one village doing like bullshit tasks? Oh fuck, the music was great. So
it even harkens back to like there's some areas in Final Fantasy VII, the original, back on, you know, like when we played that, like I would just stay there forever just listening to some of those OSTs, and it was just you know, it's just amazing. And this game, the whole game just has this lighthearted and silly sort of, you know, to go along with the way that everything's written, sort of soundtrack. But some of them are actually pretty epic. There's some battle music in this game that's epic, because they all have this rock undertone to them. And they're so good. And there's one, it's like an anime fight rock. And it fits the theme of what the boss is doing, which is a very anime villain. Man, is that track good. And it's like, it's always fun to get in a boss battle because of that, because of the music that goes with it. But this one, I was just like so ready to go, you know. I was like, I could listen to the OST in this. I don't say that lightly because I don't talk too much about OSTs, and most games have good music. I mean, it's rare that I ever play through a game and say, wow, the music in that game sucked ass. But but this game really is like something special. The music is, it's like almost worth playing just for that alone. So those were the easy, lighthearted, this is all great conversation. So let's get into, I guess now more of the discussion for certain elements that might be more heavily scrutinized. And let's start with, not the battle system, we'll get to that. Let's start with the characters, because this is another thing that people were disappointed to find out about, like there's no real return to form with partners. Although we kind of do get partners, still nowhere near, you know, what you used to have, and you can't control any of the characters, but But regardless, there's characters in the game. Some of them act as somewhat partners, but there's also a lot of other characters in the game in general that, you know, might not have any effect on the battle system at all, but they're just there to begin with. So starting off with the main one would be Olivia, who is your partner in crime along the entire adventure. She's your sidekick, your navvy, if you will.
Listen.
Yeah, except not, you know, annoying. Yeah, she's great. She's a great companion. She's fun. She's energetic. She has a lot of silly, fun dialogue. There are moments where she's lame and hand-holdy. Like saying something that's so obvious that I'm like, even a baby would know this. You don't have to explain it. And that kind of level of hand-holdy bugs me. And then there's other elements where her dialogue is just flat and non-creative. But there's most of the way she is very fun, fruitful. And it's one of those things, I think it's a side effect a little bit of when a character is a genuine sweetheart, because that's kind of what Olivia is.
Okay.
Like, everything's amazing. She's all about love and friendship, basically, right? And anytime that kind of comes up, especially in like anime scenarios, like I always go, I'm probably going to hate that character because their dialogue's
no one's
always
that realistic.
Yeah. And it's just like their dialogue's just like boring, because it's all like, that's great. Friendship's the
super
best.
Super amazing. Like, yeah.
Yeah. And that dialogue's like never, but she's not at all like that. Like she's sweet. And there's some moments where it is like that, but most of the time she's just, it's kind of a ditz. And that makes it fun. So she's probably one of the best sidekicks in a Paper Mario game.
Cool.
In a Mario game, I guess, period. So that's cool. And then besides Olivia, obviously there's a lot more. So you have Bobby, right? Olivia and Bobby are like the two that most people talk about. And especially because they're early game, you know, you get to meet them early on. Olivia, obviously, like kind of right off the bat. And then Bobby's one of the first sort of partner characters that you meet. And I think Bobby is great. I don't think Bobby is as amazing as like people talk him out to be. I think a lot of times he's more flat than I'd like him to be. I'm more of a critic than a lot of people go in that regard, more of a perfectionist when it comes to writing and everything. But I think, at first I was kind of disappointed and I was like, why do people think this character's so great? But as the story develops, he becomes really good, and he actually does end up becoming a really lovable character and a memorable character. There's things that happen in the game that you're like, what? Bobby ended up being a thumbs up.
Okay.
So if you're slightly disappointed like I was at the first, like keep at it. It gets better. And then of course there's some other characters like Professor Toad. You've seen him in trailers, you know, the one that's dressed in like the explorer outfit and everything. And he is,
yeah, I saw that. He's so fine.
I'm kind of 50-50 on him. So yeah, most of the time I liked him, but there were times where I was just like, nah. And then Kamek and Bowser Jr. were like some of my favorite. Like, that was, like, some of the most fun I had with the game is once you get them into your party. They're a riot. Their dynamic, their chemistry together is just amazing. And then their, like, their dialogue even with Mario and interactions with him is superb. And then Luigi, he kind of bugged me more than I liked. There were some moments where I liked him, but more often than not, I was just like, he's kind of annoying. I know a lot of people liked him, but I found him more annoying than anything. At first, he was fun, and then he just kind of got... I think part of the problem there is he was redundant, like, or not redundant, repetitive. Bowser was really fun. I will tell you that I will spoil this, and I will say he is not the end game boss. So this game doesn't end up pulling a bullshit move where it says, Bowser's the guy that you fight. No, that doesn't happen. So you can rest easy there. He's a fun character, and his dialogue's funny. And then I guess really that leaves King Ollie. He's a serviceable villain. His reason for wanting this world domination, so to speak, was pretty ridiculous, but it kind of works with the game. It's very basic, very primitive, very silly. And then outside of that, of course, you had this confetti explosion of toads everywhere. And everyone hates that concept initially, you know, on the surface value level, because it's like everyone's sick of toads. They almost kind of make fun of that in this game, which is kind of funny. But each toad is so fun. Like, their one-liners are just great. And you got to give so much credit to the writer of this game, because there's like hundreds of toads. And almost all of them. Yeah, and almost all of them. They're all like little one-liner, two-liners at most. Almost all of them are very entertaining. So that's pretty impressive. So that's pretty much all I have to say about characters. Overall, I know there's a lot of concern with, you know, like it being all Mario-based stuff and more simple.
Mm.
They ended up being pretty damn good characters, though. So I was really happy with it by the end.
If you could kind of lightly compare this one's characters to that one, what do you think was the biggest difference, if you could kind of sum it up? Because it seems like you kind of are favoring a thousand-year door.
Part of that's going to be nostalgia.
Mm-hmm.
But the other part of that is just, I mean, Thousand Year Door, I mean, it's well known for its uniqueness of characters.
Okay.
So the developers of Paper Mario have now come out and said that since Sticker Star, Nintendo has actually restricted them now to modifying characters at all. Like, they're not allowed to put characters in costumes and all this kind of stuff. Like, for the most part, I think that there's some very, very minor gray areas in there. So everything sort of has to be within the Mario world and to its, you know, original design. And that kind of holds it back, because in Thousand Year Door, you know, the characters that you grow, you know, in this journey with, and even the villains were like, well, the characters that you would meet, most of them were from, of course, the Mario universe, but they all had, like, you know, their own colors, their own costumes, and then personalities to go along with them. And the, you know, the characters in this game, like the Bob-omb or Bobby, and then, you know, Kamek and Bowser Jr. They're Kamek, they're Bowser Jr., they're Bob-omb, they're, you know, like, they're basic. They have the traditional look that they always have. They're not unique, but they do have that fun personality, but it doesn't break original character like, you know, the Thousand Year Door did. And that goes double for the villains, because obviously Thousand Year Door and even Super Paper Mario had villains that were just newly created and fabricated for this. Even Rogueport, you know, like the main setting for Thousand Year Door was a completely original place. And whereas this one is like, it's the Mushroom Kingdom and you're in Toad Town. It's definitely like on a creative level, a few notches down from something like Thousand Year Door. Again, this game is not Thousand Year Door. And if you go into it comparing it to Thousand Year Door, that's where you're going to start to set yourself up for disappointment. But you know what it's kind of like? It's kind of like a lot of people say Final Fantasy VI is the best game. Other people say Final Fantasy VII is the best game. Right? That's like somebody basically saying, well, Final Fantasy VI isn't as good as VII, so it's not a good game. Whereas you'd have a whole slew of Final Fantasy VI fans getting all pissed off. And that's sort of how I kind of look at this game, too, a little bit. Let's talk about this battle system.
Alrighty.
This is, without a doubt, the biggest thing you see online. People complaining about, and before the game even came out officially, this was the thing that everyone was pooping on. And I, you know what, I get it. This battle system is what you see. There's nothing that the trailers or anything didn't tell you at this point, or nothing, no videos that you haven't watched that will change your perspective of the battle system. It is exactly what I thought. And as some, I will say this, as somebody that was disappointed after learning all about it and playing it and it being what I was expecting, it's not bad. Like, it's actually, there are times where the battle system gets really, really simple and it's like turning one dial and it's like not a puzzle at all or challenge at all. And in those moments, it's disappointing, right? But then there's other times where, like, I was legitimately stumped on a couple of them. Okay. And I ended up using the toad help, where you pay the toads the money so that they, if you pay them enough, like they, it's kind of random what they do, but like once you pass certain thresholds, you can pay them, or that you pay them, they'll actually rotate and do a part of the puzzle for you. Oh. There's a lot of battles where I actually did that because I couldn't solve it. And then there's even a lot of battles, and it's more like late game stuff too, mm-hmm. that I did that, and then I still couldn't solve it, even with the first half solved for me. And so it actually, and I am somebody that likes puzzles. So if you hate puzzles, yeah, you might hate this more than someone like me, but if you like puzzles at all, like, I mean, it's actually kind of enjoyable at times, just like everyone else. I do agree that the battle system does sort of wear out its welcome relatively quickly,
mm-hmm.
but you don't have to fight all that often, and most of the battles that you get into, because one of the things that you'll hear everybody talk about is the motivation without the experience points, right? And the thing is, most of the battles are like a requirement. So it's either in order to save a toad or to get just from point A to point B, okay. you either have to battle, or it'll be very, very hard to avoid the battle. So it's kind of like you have to battle. And in those moments, the motivation is just to progress.
Okay, so it's more like progression to get you to the next part of the story or whatever.
Yeah, and okay. it's fine. And so here's my perspective on all this. I almost see the battles as something that you try to avoid. The gameplay is good enough on its own that, like, actually trying to get around battles is fun. And so that almost becomes the thing that you try to do, the engagement that you have. Because I've seen people say, well, if you're trying to avoid one of the main elements of the game, then doesn't that just say that that sucks? But I say no, because trying to avoid it actually became the fun. Mm. And then if you get caught, it almost becomes like a fuck, like a moment where like...
Like a punishment for fucking up.
Yeah, like that moment where like, ah, damn it. And in that sense, there's a reason to fight. And because you don't fight super often, it doesn't make it that taxing or tiring. And I know even this makes it sound like I'm making excuses for it, but it's really not that bad. But it's not unfun, at least not for me. Even when it wore out its welcome, it wasn't unfun. It was just kind of like going through the motions. Mm-hmm. And I would say the battle system in this is less excruciating than a traditional RPG. And each battle, even the simple ones where it's just basic Goombas,
mm-hmm.
end up being interesting because, like, you're engaging your brain. You have to solve this puzzle. They do another interesting thing with the battles is that after a while, you get strong enough. And when you revisit previous areas, or you encounter enemies that aren't very strong, like your basic Goombas, you can actually hit them with a hammer before they touch you, and it'll just kill them, and it'll turn them into confetti and coins, so you don't even have to fight them. But the other motivation to the battle system too, though, is the confetti and the coins. Again, I know in our initial conversation, our noob episode that we did, and I gave my brief initial impressions of the game, I was like, you really don't need to do this for confetti, because confetti's everywhere, and same with coins. I still kind of stand by that for the confetti aspect, because you don't get much confetti from battles anyway, but coins actually do become pretty necessary, especially toward the later half, and things start getting really expensive. And you could blow through 10 to 15,000 coins just on two items like that. So battling and getting those coins and completing the puzzles to get that extra coin bonus and everything is so, it feels so good when you get that collection of coins. And then you also need it to, if you are in a battle that's, if you wanna end the battle quickly, you wanna solve that puzzle.
Okay.
And sometimes if you're having a hard time solving that puzzle, you need to pay the toads at least 100+ coins. And then anytime you wanna extend your timer, every 100 coins is like 10 seconds. So you have to spend a couple hundred coins to get extra time. So the coins really drive everything. So like, it's like the battle systems motivate themselves, basically.
Okay, that makes sense.
The motivation is there. It's not traditional. but it's there. And I would say that it's more about the engagement of the battle system, which is actually could be arguably more entertaining than a traditional RPG. And then, of course, you got to start talking about the boss battles, and the boss battles are fucking fun.
Okay.
I loved every single boss battle that I played, and they're all they increasingly get difficult. And they have you do new things. And it's all about doing this ring to get around it. It's not terribly difficult all the time to get the ring to do what you want.
Mm-hmm.
It's the other elements that they incorporate into the strategy of beating the boss that makes it more difficult. And surprisingly, like, there's some bosses that I actually struggled on. There's one boss in particular, I won't say which, I died on twice. I struggled with it twice, and it ended up taking me like an hour to beat it because just figuring out what to do. There was one boss battle I even ashamedly admit that I had to use the Olivia tip. I tried to make a point to not use the tips or advice. And there's one battle I had to use. I just could not figure it out, and I didn't want to use a strategy guide. And even then it was a little obscure. There's a couple of these boss battles that are, you know what? They're all fantastic. Yeah, it's a little tacky, right? Because they're all stationary bosses. But they're so creative, and they're so much fun, and the way that you have to beat all of them are great. And the Velamentals are also really difficult. They're also a lot of fun. And there's some extra bosses that are sprinkled out throughout your adventure too. Just try it, because you don't always have to fall into what the popular opinion is. Like, you know, not all the time is that the way things are. Just try it. We all have differences of opinions. And I ended up really liking the battle system, even though it wears out its welcome. I still really liked it. And I actually think that they could even dig further into this in future titles and make it a little bit extra challenging too. I would welcome that future. So yeah, that's hopefully eases some minds when it comes to the battle system. I have mostly positive things to say about it.
Cool.
And then, of course, that finally brings us to the last little bit, which is just the general gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
And this is also, I kind of touched on it a little bit with the battle system, but this is why I also think the battle system isn't too big of a deal, because the gameplay itself is so good.
Okay.
And it's classic Nintendo. It's so polished, so responsive. It's just a joy to move around. And each location is so fun to experience and check all the nooks and crannies. There's a lot of little OCD helpers in there for me. You can see in the trailer, there's a section of the game where you have to drive around this little shoe clown car thing. That's a lot of fun to ride around in. And then there's a boat that you ride around in, which is fun. But yeah, it's just a joy how polished the controls are, as you would expect from a Nintendo title. And even talking to the NPCs is a good time. Like, that normally is kind of a burden in a video game, and in this one, it's so welcoming. So there's if I had to make one criticism, it would be that every time you do sort of the summon thing that happens in the game, it always plays the cutscene. You can skip it.
Oh, it's the animation.
But it always plays it, and then you have to skip it. And I'm like, it's not really entertaining. After you see it the first time, I can't imagine anyone that wants to watch it ever again. I would say that just skip that kind of stuff in the future altogether, or like have an option in the menu that lets you skip that altogether. And then the only other criticism I would say is, because everything's so paper thin. Sometimes when you walk up to an NPC, the hitbox to hit the A button to talk with them is very narrow. So sometimes you'll have to position yourself just perfect. So great gameplay for this game is Nintendo. It's top notch. No day one patches. That's pretty crazy. I guess if I had to have a conclusion statement on all of this that I said, would be that I said it at the beginning, but it's now currently one of my favorite games on the Switch. And it's a shame that it's getting as many like sort of punches as it is, because I think it's fantastic.
So in summation, where would this one go in order for of your list of the games you've played in the series so far when it comes to, let's say, most favorite to least favorite? Where would this one fit in for you?
So I could easily let nostalgia put this in fourth place, but I feel like that almost does it injustice because that's basically only saying it's better than Sticker Star or Color Splash. And I don't really think that that's true. I think it's better than that. I would say that this might be, if I remove my nostalgia, like, because I really did like the story and everything of Super Paper Mario, but the gameplay in that game, I didn't enjoy as much as the other one. I would probably put this one above that one personally. And the only reason I don't put it above the original Paper Mario is because of nostalgia. Thousand Year Door, I think, even without nostalgia, I think is still the best in the series. But I also encourage people to not measure this game based on the other Paper Marios, because the last two sucked, it's not fair to say that it's only better than those or anything. And just judge it on its own merit. And enjoy it as if it's its own individual experience, and it is a blast. If you even are marginally considering this game, do it. And if you're disappointed, you can be like, fuck you, Dustin.
That cost me money, you son of a bitch.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's so good.
All right, pretty fair assessment.
Yeah. -5 must buy.
No, I think that is a pretty good roundup. Yeah.
Well, hope you enjoyed that. Hope you got something out of it. If you were on the fence, hopefully that swayed you to give it a shot. And if you didn't like it, you know, you can tell me I'm a fucking idiot in the comments. That's fine, too. But yeah, if you like this content, you know, make sure to give us a subscribe. Hit that like button. It really helps us out. Leave a comment. Let us know what you think. Let us know if there's anything else you want us to talk about in the future. We'd be happy to get into all that. Yep. Anyway, until the next video, guys, we'll see you next time. Cheers.
Later, guys. Yeah.